emotion receives. So you have to then have a conversation with yourself, because it's impossible to not feel what you feel.
Excellent. This distinction is so important. Otherwise, what can happen is, anything happens that has, you know, we have these emotional centers. They will give us a certain input. Suppose you try to suppress it. It can lead to disaster. So please understand, because you know, if you try to follow this literally, what will happen? So I had a friend. So sometimes when you just read like that and you don't think about it properly. So she says, you know, a doctor got maybe she's a nice guy. And now she says, oh, I can't get elated and I can't get. So then she's trying to keep so-called equilibrium. And her daughter comes to her and says, Mom, aren't you happy? You know, it's like I'm getting engaged. My husband comes and says, Mom, this is such a nice occasion, but you're not like enjoying yourself. So you're trying to, so then she says, I was trying to keep a balance, an equilibrium. So that will make you a very artificial person who is not able to respond appropriately to situations. So life is not supposed to be. So please understand that your emotional life cannot be flat like this. It's not possible. Right? And if you try, if your goal is to make it flat like this, that means you are in some kind of a denial, or most likely there is some block that you have created. So what happens is, this particular thing is, you know, sometimes people who have gone through a big trauma, right? Now, and at that given point in time, they are not able to cope with that trauma. So what happens is, they block some centers. So that blocking of the centers will allow them to cope with that event, which is in front of them. And that's a very common coping mechanism. You block the centers so that you are able to cope. And for that time, it may be useful also. But over a period of time, you cannot just live as though with this block. Why? Because there is a natural process of feeling that emotion which is not felt. And if you don't take care of that, what will happen is your only method of coping with your emotional life will be blocking. So there was a big article in one newspaper, the neuroscience newspaper, and they said that if you block your pain centers, you will also block your pleasure centers. So that means your whole life is lived with only a block. So that means you're not able to, you're not able, and that's a handicap. That's not something which is to be exalted, right? We are not talking about, you know, this living with a block, which is so far seeming. In fact, this is, in psychology, is considered to be something which needs to be taken care of. It is unhealthy, it is not possible, and there is some kind of a denial. And this is, please don't make it into a wise person. This is not a wise person. So that means, what we need to understand when we are talking about samatha, there are two things that we need to keep in mind. This is not coming as, oh, I should not be elated, I should not be depressed. It's not about, it's not an advice. It's not something that you try to bring all your emotions here. It actually comes from understanding. What understanding? That emotions are passing. That you can't expect anything to be permanent anyway, and that true joy comes from something else. Okay. So one thing is, it comes from the understanding, the most fundamental, right? Things, the situations that come to your life, some of them are pleasant and some of them are unpleasant. But some, they come not because life is treating you badly, not because life is unfair, not because life is random, but it is because there is this whole network of laws which are at work, which come together to give you the result. This understanding itself will, you know, it will keep you from jumping to the conclusion when things happen which are not exactly as you
wanted them to happen, it will not lead for you to conclude that, oh, you know, this why me, why all these things keep happening to me. This kind of a thought will not come. Because you see that the world in which you are living is not kind of an unfair world which is out there to get you. But it is just too many, and all Ishvara is impersonal. Please don't make Ishvara personal. Personal means problematic. Impersonal means just intelligence which connects everything and gives you the situation that is beauty. Okay. Now with that, if you understand that, then what will happen is, instead of reacting more, you will enter into problem solving. So this is exactly what you want to accomplish. Now, that situation will arise and this understanding will give you a certain conclusion, because you will not lead, it will not lead to a conclusion that life has been unfair to me, or I am not good, or why all these things only keep happening to me. These kind of thoughts are not going to help you in any way. So that means you move away from that and move into problems. Okay. It also comes from, now part of this understanding is also something which is very important, that every different situations call for different emotions. So that means if you go for a wedding and if you are naturally healthy, what is the mood that you have to have naturally? Celebration, joy, right? I mean, you don't need to think about, you don't have to say, now how should I feel when I go for a wedding? Suppose somebody is in a hospital and you are going to see that person, what is the mood that naturally everybody has? A little bit somber, a little bit concerned, right? So this is something you can't have wherever you go, just one mindset. So that means this fluctuation of emotion is something which is natural, which is healthy, and it is rational, right? Changing situations call for changing emotional response. Okay. Now, when is this, then, so therefore, equanimity that we are talking about is not this, but a natural flow of emotion which is in keeping with the situation. The situation, right? There is a rational behavior. Now, when we are talking about equanimity, what actually happens is, suppose there is a thing of celebration, an occasion of celebration. And suppose, so now let's take this woman that I don't know, she came to me saying that I was trying to be equanimous and how everybody was saying, aren't you happy, aren't you, kind of, you know. So I told her that, you know, this happiness is something which is very natural. What happens is sometimes our happiness reaches an artificial peak. What is this artificial peak? This artificial peak is a result of your added story to that event. Suppose you start telling yourself, now I have got this such a lovely boy, so I am the most cool person. And then you kind of try to look down and see my friends are struggling and see how nice, such a great boy I got. That is what we call a joy which comes from distorted thinking. Because you are deriving pleasures from somebody else's, you imagine somebody else's, you know, they are not doing as well. Or your thing is like, yeah, now I'm the queen. Hey, nobody is a queen, because life presents its own challenges to everybody. Whether you are, so Swamiji used to say, either you are comfortably unhappy or you are uncomfortably unhappy. So that means unhappiness or different occasions of, you know, different laws or anything, all of us have to go through. So therefore, this artificial peaks when we create from our own thinking, by thinking that I'm the coolest person now, that's not true. That you are privileged, that you are grateful, wonderful, right? And you are very happy that you got this nice guy. But now, because of that, I am the you know, I have now reached some heights, and now you create your own self-importance.
that is a bubble. That bubble, the joy that you get out of this bubble is actually elevation, but it has to, it will come down. And when it comes down, because when the reality shows itself, this bubble will lead to not just this down, it will lead to much further down. So that means the higher and higher bubble you have created of your superiority, when situations happen which are not in keeping with what you want, then you will go down even further than the normal down. So that equanimity that we are talking about is not this, this is natural. It, we are talking about this artificial up and artificial down, which is not in keeping with situation, but it is in keeping with our own distortions, which make us see the world in a certain way. The more and more you come to the facts, the mind is able to abide in the facts, it is able to experience this normal change and flow of emotions effortlessly, and all these peaks of elation which come from your own bubble and the peaks of low periods, they will begin to go. So this is the equanimity that we are talking about. So you have to be very careful when you talk about equanimity, what is it that you have in mind? Because suppose you have this in mind, it's going to drive you crazy.
This chapter reads it very differently.
That's exactly. I said it sounds like crazy, right?
Yeah.
It sounds like, yeah, be equal in everything. It's not really what it. This is why I ask
you
agree with it.
Take the other one.
Yeah.
That
so that's why. And it's interesting because, see, my teacher was, I thought he was outstanding. But sometimes when I read this, it doesn't represent what he's saying. So that's why sometimes when you write or in editing or the person who hears, that person, what, adds their own ideas. So this is why I wanted to make it absolutely clear that we are not talking about some kind of, no matter what happens to you, you just remain the same. That will make you crazy. And in fact, this is a handicap. According to psychology, it's not something to be exalted. Right? But the artificial ups and downs are our doing because of our stories. Because of our added stories, which create suffering and artificial ups for us, which actually are unhealthy. This is how arrogance comes. This is how, you know, our bubbles can be of the nature of I am the coolest, I am this. Hey, that's not true. You are good, wonderful. But you see, so that is something that we need to be careful to use. Okay, so now let's read further. Now this story is something which is even, it's so we'll talk about it. So who will, Rajiv, you want to read? No. So Anupa,
when did you stop?
The following response attributed.
The following response attributed to a great Stoic philosopher upon hearing tragic news illustrates reduction of facts to facts. The philosopher was waiting for the news of the safe arrival of a large sailing ship, carrying his wife and children and all his wealth, answered a knock on his door and found a breathless messenger who announced, "Sir, the ship carrying your family and wealth has sunk." "What? The ship has sunk? So what?" "Sir, you have lost all your wealth." "What? Your fortune is gone. So what?" "Sir, nothing was salvaged. You are penniless." "What? You are a pauper." "So what?" "Sir, no one survived. You've lost your wife and children." "What? You are a childless widower." "So what?" When the philosopher each time said, "What?" it was neither because he had not heard the words, nor because he failed to understand the sentence. He had heard and he had understood. But he said, what? Because at first he refused to accept it. Since it was not acceptable, he said, "What?" Not to the messenger really, but to himself. It was his initial refusal to accept the particular fact that each time made him say, first say what. But being a philosopher, he did not hang on to non-acceptance. The ship has sunk, so what? There is nothing I can do about it. I am a pauper. Well, so what? I am penniless. I made money and lost it. Now I work to make it again. My wife and children are gone. Grief and despair won't bring them back. They are gone. That is a sad fact. I assimilate the facts and do what is required of me under the circumstances. There are pleasant facts and unpleasant facts. There are comfortable facts and uncomfortable facts. And all the time the facts keep changing. Now pleasant, now not so pleasant. Now comfortable, now uncomfortable. The weather is hot, the weather is just right, the weather is too cold. I feel on top of the world, I've come down with the flu. Each day brings facts of all kinds. My job is to greet all facts with sameness of mind. I accept and enjoy the comfortable facts for what they are, the facts of the moment. Similarly, I accept without reaction the uncomfortable facts for what they are. I simply do whatever the situation calls for. If I can make an uncomfortable fact more comfortable, I do so. If I cannot, I accept and do whatever is required.
Okay, now let's talk here. How does this sound?
You can accept the situation.
It sounds like computer modeling.
I mean, it would be ideal, but it's hard to do.
At that moment you accept, but the next moment you do whatever it takes.
It's almost impossible, right? You're going to have some emotion. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So see, when you read these, so I have to tell you one story that somebody read this book and wrote to one of, I mean, not something I didn't know. So wrote to one of the girls who organizes my talks in Germany, and he said, this is an outstanding book, but I found one chapter and para totally problematic. And it was this.
Yes.
And he says, what is this? You know, suppose you lose, you get the news that your child and you've lost all your wealth and you've lost your wife and you've lost your kids, and you say, so what? What kind of a thing is this? Right? Yeah. So this is something which is, so then she says, well, I didn't know how to respond. So you have to first see what is it saying, right? It cannot be this. It cannot be this because it's totally unrealistic, right? So what we need to see is what is being said is what and so what it stands for. What we need to see is that.
It's paused, right?
Yeah. Is what is like a disbelief, right?
So this what and so what is not, please don't take it literally, because if you take it literally, it sounds like a crazy story, right? So what stands for, and so what? What does it stand for? What stands for?
Surprise and
disbelief. Disbelief.
Shock also.
Shock.
It's not processed. It's not processed.
Non-process, excellent. That means non-process, let's put it initial reaction. Yeah? Does that fit?
Yes.
Yeah. Non-acceptance. Something which has already happened, but your mind is not trying to deny it. It's like denial, like non-acceptance. So this is what stands for. What does so what stand for? It doesn't mean, oh, so what, I don't care. It's not that. What does it stand for?
Now what can I do?
Excellent.
How to solve it.
Excellent. What can I do? How do I solve it? How can I emotionally be with it? Excellent. Chirag, can you share your wisdom with us?
I don't mind Anupala.
No, Chirag. Chirag, please.
Anupala,
what was it? His cracks is good. It's good to
add. I was told, you're wearing Aruba. I said, what?
stand for indifference. It doesn't stand for like, yeah, everything happens, it's the same. But actually, what happens is, so let's look at it in terms of neurosciences. I think I've talked about it many times. In our brain, there are two centers. One is what we call amygdala, which is the prefrontal cortex. So this is something which is what your immediate, it's a little impulsive in the sense that this is your initial, this will produce your initial reaction. So as the situations occur, you have an emotional side of you or that particular, the instinctive side of you, which will produce a certain reaction. Now that nobody can stop this. Why can't you stop this? Because this is part of the human brain. It's a design, right? So nobody can erase that design. And nobody can say, oh, I don't want to feel this. That is something that you feel, right? Now, well, generally what happens is that if this part, if your prefrontal cortex, generally what happens is we use only for learning math, learning physics, learning business, learning accounting. So that means this prefrontal cortex of yours can be highly trained, but not with reference to yourself and your reactions and your brain understanding. So there can be a situation you are a genius with reference to other things in the world, but with reference to your own personal life and your own emotional life, you totally operate from here. Why would that be? Because nobody teaches us to how to use our prefrontal cortex emotional out. Exactly. So this is why I say what Vedanta does is not giving you an advice of how you should feel, how you should not feel. It actually strengthens your prefrontal cortex, that thinking with reference to yourself, which is underutilized. And when you incorporate yourself into your prefrontal cortex, your ability to manage this instinctive emotions becomes much higher over a period of time than if you had not actually thought about it. So this is why it's actually educating it. It's actually making it understand things much better with reference to yourself. So this is a very important thing. The minute I begin to understand the world differently and my role in the world differently, what will happen is my ability to deal with these instinctive reactions will become much better. If I have not invested in this knowledge, what will happen is, when things are shocking, I will operate from here. Because I don't know any other way. And when I operate from here, what is my mindset?
It's very immature.
Exactly. It's very immature. It's very instinctive.
You don't have any chance to reflect on how you're working.
Yeah, absolutely. It's highly reactive. Instinctive, reactive. It's all based on first impression and the message that I get, rather than reflecting on what exactly can I do. So this is a very common thing. And you know, it's interesting. So many people, you know, so like I know some wives whose husbands are CEOs and they are so well regarded in the so-called business circles and very respected and all that. And they say this person is a crazy. At home, that person is so difficult to deal with because they are totally narcissist. They are all self-important, self-absorbed, and they think that everything has to happen as they want it to. And she says, many of them say that it's impossible to live with them because they just don't have simple sensitivities, even with reference to their kids, the kind of standards they set for them and how the kind of pressures they put for them. It's unreal. And the same person is so well regarded. So
So this is a classic example of your it's not that your prefrontal cortex is not developed, it is developed, but
only for external matter.
Only for external matters. So then four. And this instinct, so unfortunately, even in spiritual circles, you don't understand this difference. So suppose I keep telling you, you should not feel this, you should not feel this. It's not possible not to feel this. Why? Because this belongs to a center of your brain which has, its job is to produce these responses. Right? And suppose I keep telling you, don't do this, it's not going to help you in any way. It is actually going to increase your burdens because nobody can stop it. Then you will suppress it. Suppression will have its own consequences. You are in denial. You don't even accept that it is there. Further problems. So therefore, the only thing that you can do is what? Make your prefrontal cortex what much more powerful, not in other matters, but with reference to yourself. When that happens, naturally, what will happen is you will move from this, which is an instinctive brain mode, to this mode, which is a thinking. So this is what actually one has to do in life, because life by definition will produce what? Nobody can control. Even the so-called wisest person has to go through so many situations which are not exactly in keeping with what one wants, right? And that's why this problem solving mode is something which is important. I told you the story about my teacher, right? That he started a hospital and
yes.
How it was
yeah.
not working.
No, okay.
So this is exactly, right? So that means he started a hospital in a tribal village to help all the people. It didn't work. Surprise. Yes, of course, right? It's not like, oh, it doesn't matter, whatever it is. But and this belief also a little bit shocking that he tried so many different things. First tribal, totally free, then he sent the doctors to the villages so that the villagers don't have to travel to the hospital by mobile vans. Then he started this education programs, health and hygiene and all that. Nothing was working. So either he can be just disappointed and give names to these tribals who are so crazy, he's offering so much help and they are not even willing to take it, or you enter into
problem
solving mode. This ability to move from here to here is actually going to make you a successful or not so successful person. And also emotionally mature person. So that means your responses have to come from a certain understanding. Now, what I want to talk about is also some, when I talk about this, people say, yeah, you're talking about a general kind of a surprise. But suppose somebody receives a very, very shocking news, right? So some people give me an example, loss of a loved one at a premature age, right? Or sometimes somebody is abused at a very young age. So, won't you, this instinct will be so powerful, right? Because at a very young age, if you're abused, it leaves a huge impression on you. Because this is what, in its formative years, so that means the impact that it has on you is a lot more than for an adult. So therefore, this is why in psychology, most of our problems are gathered between age, 0 to 5. Why? Because at that time, our brain is developing. So a simple fact, which for an adult is not so difficult to deal with, but for a child, it is huge. And for the child, it is huge. And the impressions that it has begins to state and dictate how the child feels for the rest of one's lives. So this is why this part of the brain is, in formative years when you have a major event,
how do you get over it? This is a question that people ask me, very often they ask me. So, what is the answer? You have a choice. That's the only answer, right? You have a choice, because as now this brain, which was in its development stage, as suppose as an adult, has now developed. And it is able to develop, means this prefrontal cortex is developed enough to process the information that it was unable to process when it was young. Either you use this prefrontal cortex to free yourself from this trauma, or you don't use it and let this trauma dictate.
But what if your prefrontal cortex is not developed?
So that's why
you work beyond your limits.
And this is why this kind of a class will enable you to develop. See, nobody, this is why we, brightest people may not have developed prefrontal cortex in reference to the matters of that class. But this is something which is given as a possibility. So either you ignore it because you are good. So if you are good at prefrontal cortex with reference to external things, you can be highly successful. So that's why what happens is we don't even at times see the need to develop this.
So you give the example of a child at 5 years, who's abused or whatever. But when you grow up, do you remember what happened to you in 5 years and how does it affect you? I mean, you might not
remember. So, in psychology, there is a whole big thing which is called the unconscious, right? So, the unconscious means, yeah, this is a good question. So, let me talk about it. It's important, right? How does this prefrontal cortex, this instinctive brain, which is amygdala, as a child, it has some, suppose it has some traumatic. There is a whole, the whole field of psychology, which is Freudian psychology, is based on this whole model. Okay. So what it says is that you have this instinctive brain, and you have your prefrontal cortex. So when you are a child, both are in their formative years, right? The human brain has not developed. This is why, see, even science recognizes, why is it that you start driving only at the age of 18? Because in your development years, this is not totally developed. Why is it that you vote when you are 21? This is the understanding. Your brain is still
even the juvenile laws are because
different. Exactly. So that means the whole everybody recognizes this, that they are your formative years. It's not totally exactly. Juvenile crime gets treated differently from an adult crime. Absolutely. Right. So that means these are your formative years. Now suppose at the age of 5 or 3 or 2 or whatever. Right. So, some event occurred, either it could be abuse, whatever, you know, please don't think it is only abuse, it's not. Suppose you see, you think the kids are, they don't know anything, they see the disharmony between father and mother. Suppose they see father and mother fighting, it what creates has an impact. So that means, all these different abuse or neglect, suppose, and this is something which is also very common in many of these Western kids, you know, when I go to Germany and all, one of the biggest problems that they have is that both parents are working.
So at a very young age, they are left with,
child care.
And there they feel what they are totally, they feel as if they are brought to this world and nobody is there to look after them. So this really, this is a huge issue in Western societies. So that means neglect, uncared for. It's not like they are abused very actively, right? Unloved.
Character.
in your life, which is a friend. What will happen is, when you perceive this friend, this feeling will interfere. Anger. So your brain will give you a message that I am, this person doesn't love me. But you don't know that it is coming from here. So you project it on this person.
I'm sorry, can you just...
So the friend will show you love, but you will feel unloved. Exactly. How the friend behaves with you is the friend can be loving. The friend, whoever the, whatever the friend is doing, is not what you are perceiving. Your perception is colored by
your
ability to process information begins to be
clouded.
But you don't recognize that it is because of this. You keep projecting here. So that means there is nothing for you to do, right? As long as you think it belongs to your friend, well, you are not ever going to solve this.
But without a 3-year-old memory, I don't remember what happened 3 years. I'm going to project that instant.
This is what I'm saying. It's blocked, but it is not gone. So it is blocked from your conscious memory. But it is not gone. And because it is not gone, but it is there in your conscious memory, then unconscious will join your present perception and it will give you feelings. But when these feelings come, you think they belong to your external situation. You don't know that these feelings come from your own unconscious. This is how.
But when you see love, you will receive it because you are in love.
This is too simplistic thinking. It's not like if life was as simple as that, and then we don't have to.
So that you get some that love.
What happens is, see, that is how. So instead of when you receive the love, then what you
deep psychology.
This impacts everybody, and nobody knows it, right? This is why what happens is consciously wonderful. So what Nirmala is saying is this is even more complex. Why is it more complex? Because consciously you are looking for love, but unconsciously, what are you doing is
rejecting,
constantly, exactly. You are rejecting and you are continuing to project on the other person this feeling of not love.
And that other person comes with their own journey.
Absolutely.
They are not even feeling.
So that means the other person also comes with their own baggage.
So you said you are constantly projecting no love. Kind of, that you're not receiving love.
You're not receiving love.
Right. So, just to simplify this whole thing, it's like my parents kept working, I had, you know, they had no time for me. They loved me, but I didn't realize that because of the absence. I loved them very much, but I wasn't getting love back. I'm start block, fast forward 20 years, right? Now, I love someone, it could be a friend of mine or whatever kind of love, right? And I feel I am expecting this person to love me back. However, it cannot be continuous projection, right? Because if this person is busy and went on a business trip and I'm not getting their attention, and that's when maybe something triggers. So it's not that it's a continuous projection. It's then that feeling is like, look, man, it's going back to look, no one loves me.
Exactly.
That's been triggered.
It's a default bias.
Exactly.
Now, if I get close, that one thing gets triggered, and I'm like, no,
the child is not happening.
So this is a perpetual relationship problem.
Unless it is dealt with properly.
And all can make you aware of it, and every time it happens, you watch the pattern and then you change it.
Which is why sometimes superficially you feel someone so nice and everything is great, but sometimes a certain trigger, just you see a different side to them.
Absolutely. So this is what also Chirag is saying is very important. There is this feeling of unlove which is kind of constant, but it is not manifesting, right? When a trigger comes, like suppose, right, that you called a friend and The friend didn't call you back for 2 days.
Yeah, and triggered.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or stress.
So that pains.
And
so that is.
Yeah, but
so,
the stress you
so then you, the whole thing of unloved, like then comes the story, then comes, oh my God. So this is not, but you can't, as long as you keep on attributing it to external events, what will happen is you'll never address this.
Never get solved.
It never gets solved and it will keep manifesting. It will keep manifesting from time to time. Either it is latent or it becomes potent as the trigger comes. So this is a human being. This is most, in fact, nobody, please don't think there are some people like that. Actually, nobody is free from this. Different things. So therefore, now, as an adult, you have been given the capacity to either solve this, or you go on like this, and your feelings will remain, and triggers will keep on creating this big reaction. So this is what this so what represents what
reflection.
So, we've identified my problem. It's been 4, 5 decades, 2 decades, depending on the person. How do you solve it?
Excellent. So that means the first.
How do you come to terms where this is okay?
Excellent.
And I don't.
Okay. Wonderful. So that means, as an adult, you have to what you are capable of is first. Now let's come to solution.
Yes,
we have seen what is the what happens. Now let's come to solution.
Solution is probably awareness.
The first step of solution is
recognizing.
To recognize that everything that I feel is not because of external world and how others are behaving. But a lot, some of it, not everything. Please don't think that everything is only because of that, right? So much of my interpretation actually belongs to my feelings and not with how people are. That is the first step. So that means that there is this whole ownership rather than always projecting on others. That the world is at turn, that this person is like that, that person is like this. We live like that. We never actually do this little self-reflection, right? That is what we call the ownership. Second, in fact, if you take the ownership and if you re-look at your life and you re-examine, that different situations occur, but your stories remain the same. So that means an unloved person, the person who's carrying this feeling of not being loved, will feel unloved with reference to spouse, with reference to friends, with reference to. So that means, as you are becoming, if you begin to reflect, you know, as you go through different situations in life, there is one common storyline which carries through. So then, through that, you kind of identify, right? What is this feeling that is with me, which stays with me, either latent or potent. Okay? So that means you identify. First you take ownership, then you look into it and you identify. After you identify, you actually, the very important thing is not to totally try to change it. You have to acknowledge and you have to validate this. What does it mean? As a child, this is how I felt, and there was a reason for it. So as a child, it is fine. Otherwise, what will happen? You will keep fighting it, and you will keep saying, why did I feel this? Why did I feel this? So then, there is this thing, validate how you felt as a child. But you can tell yourself that now I'm an adult, I don't need to the same thing. So that is what we call empowering yourself. Right? So that means at that time it was fine. Otherwise what will happen? Now you will feel guilty. So before you felt unloved and now you feel guilty, it's not productive. Okay? So he said, it's okay as a child, but now I can do something about it. Then, when you can say you can do something about it, this feeling of unloved, there can be, as an adult, now I'm talking, you're processing it, right? So that means, when you're processing it as an adult, there can be different reasons, because now you're capable of that. So suppose it was just simple thing, right? Like my parents went to work, and I felt that I was, and I'm speaking from people coming to me and telling me how they feel and how they have lived their life. I'm not just speaking from the air. So there was this woman who came to me and she says both her parents were doctors and very, very successful. So they were out all the time from morning to evening. She says, as a child, I felt so left alone because there was this nanny who was looking after me. And I'm like, where are my parents? They're not there from morning to evening. And she felt extremely unloved. So now, as an adult, what she can do, and that started interfering with how she felt with her husband, with many other things, and you know, diffident kid, unloved kid, this is how she was behaving. She was 40 years old, right? So now, you can correct this picture. So this unloved as a child is valid, but as an adult, you can correct the story, and you can tell yourself, my parents loved me, but they were busy. This is what we call correction. As an adult, you are able to correct these stories and make them as accurate as possible and not from the child's perception. Suppose the scenario was different, right? Suppose the scenario was that you felt unloved because your parents kept praising your sister. And your parents did, even though they loved you, they didn't praise you enough. That's a totally another cause. The feeling is the same, unloved. So now, you have to do yet another correction. So what, in that correction, if you try to convince yourself that what, my parents love me equally, it will not work. Because it is not the truth. So what you have to tell is, yes, my parents what, because that is the truth, what in my, as far as I remember, they praised, suppose my mother praised my sister much more than my mother praised me. As a child, I felt unloved, and this is the reason why. But as an adult, I can say, was my mother the only character in my life? As a child, when I was growing up, was she the only character in my life? The input came from her as though she preferred my sister, suppose. But I had my father, I had my siblings, I had my friends. So how were they with reference to me? You will see a totally different picture. Means what happens is, this is facts. You're just staying with facts. Facts means you're not trying to convince yourself things which are not true, but you're seeing, you're increasing your clarity about what happened. Suppose you do research, right? And there is this number of data, and you take only one and you make conclusion. What is going to be the outcome of your research? Biased, skewed. Here is exactly the same. There were different characters in your life. They treated you differently. Some of them, I'm sure, loved you a lot. But somebody behaved like this. What happens is, as a child, you only carried one response, which is how your mother treated you. And you carried the feeling around you, and you kept all the other people who treated you well are.
Or you could have a conversation with yourself that my mother had her own problems and that's why she...
That's the first thing, but you first need to also correct this. Otherwise what will happen is only this remains a reality and you keep trying to correct it. The whole
intensity of this will automatically reduce. Then the next step is you can understand. But otherwise what will happen, if you don't increase the picture, you are only looking at one variable and giving it 100% and then trying to solve it. It still will have problems. So that means your correction has to be as true to reality as possible. And as expansive and as complete as possible. As it becomes more and more complete, without denying that this is how she behaved, or without, you don't have to deny that. But it, that itself is put in its perspective. It's not the only input you received as a child. It is one of the inputs that you received. That itself will give a lot of relief. Right? Then the third step is, so that means, yeah, she was like that, but a lot of others were really good. So that means you correct the whole picture. Then you can go to the step that Namo was talking about, and then you understand that, hey, she said something, not because she was mean to me or she didn't love me. She was also constrained by her own conditioning, her own vision of things. So that means that is not my problem. It is what her vision at that time, and she could have changed in the meantime. It's not like, oh, she is this evil person. No, not at all. She that's not what she could do at that time, and given her circumstances.
Generally, so mothers pamper the. A child which is a bit weak, they don't give attention to the stronger child. This is always happens.
So this also, I got a case like this. That now it's interesting how life evolves. It's interesting, no? Somebody came to me and said, now this is a mother who comes. The mother who comes, and so there are three sisters. And I know all three of them. So the other sisters always told me that my mother favored this child, the eldest. Because the eldest one had asthma and whatever. So the mother, exactly, she was weaker, so the mother was looking after her more. Now, so the other two sisters always felt that my mother always favored my elder sister. Now, what has happened is, this elder sister is growing up, and the elder sister is the so-called favored one. Now she has cancer, the eldest. Now according to these two sisters, she is the most favored one. Now this woman who has cancer, she is putting up a very brave front in front of everyone else, and very factual and very distinct. All her anger comes towards her mother. Mother has become the dumping ground. Because she is this child which is favored all the time and looked after so well. So the child, she feels safe. So she wants to put up a brave front in front of everyone. And who has become the dumping ground? The mother. So this is an irony. Why is it? That's what I said. You go along with your distortion and how complex life becomes. It is interesting because for the two other two sisters, who is the favorite? The eldest. The mother gets most abused by who? The eldest.
Why is that? It happens somehow.
Because of couples being exactly. So that means you are always favored. What does it mean you are always favored? You can do anything. You can throw a tantrum. You can do anything. And the mother will be nice to you. So this has become the pattern. So the very favor actually becomes a reason for you to be spoiled. So that means a very favorite child is now what? Suffering.
And your suffering is that.
The dumping of her suffering goes to her mother. Because the relationship that she has created with her mom is, she'll do anything and the mother will love her and say nothing. Do you understand the monsters that we create? Mm. And we are so entangled.
people did it. And we don't know what's going on. We attribute everything to outside, and all of this is yours to process. This is a big thing. So that all this is required. If you don't do this, rest of your life will go like this. So therefore, the now what you need to do is what the circle, not only then understand where the person was coming from. Then, if possible, it all depends upon how that other person is. If you can bring some closure, now that depends upon what is the maturity of that person, how is this person able to take it when you talk about it. Some closure is very, very helpful. So that means, suppose you can't, one possibility is your mother is still alive, and you can go and talk to her in a nice way and say, you know, this is my perception, and I'm actually not blaming you, but I'm trying to understand, and it has left an impact on me, and I'm trying to work on it, and I just wanted to see this. And now, so let me come back to the story. Right now, the mother comes to me and she tells me that my other two daughters are telling me that I am favoring her, but this daughter is abusing me the most. Because now that eldest daughter is actually.
But now they have developed that relationship.
Exactly.
Okay.
So now it is at. Now she further goes along with it by saying that, oh, she has her own issues, now she's suffering from cancer. So she continues with the same matter. And yeah, let her do that. It's okay.
This
same
thing.
Compensating.
So
exactly. Absolutely. Now, I told her, so the mother is also suffering. Everybody is suffering. The daughter is suffering. The other two are suffering because they feel unloved. The loved one is suffering because she is trying to put up a big front but dumping everything on her mom. Mom is a recipient of that abuse, and she feels now if I say something to her, everybody is suffering. This is how we create our own mess. Now, I told this mom, I said, you know what, it's good to love your daughter, but if you indiscriminately allow her to abuse you, then what? You're not doing her a favor. Don't think that you're doing her a favor. In fact, that choice that she's making will have consequences. So, if you, in your own way, you have to tell her that, hey, when you behave like this, it hurts. And so that means that it is not okay. Right? Exactly. It's not okay to treat anybody like that. So this is how you begin to do connections. But if things have been wrong for a number of years and if they are entangled, it takes time. Nothing can happen overnight. But it is this whole practice. First, you have to sort it out in your head. What's going on? Then you have to work towards a solution, and you have to be ready that it will take the entanglement of years. The solution is going to take some time. It's not going to be overnight. But if you don't work towards it, it will get worse. And it will get further entanglement. And it will affect your own perception of everything else and yourself. And it will affect others, you, others also. Because you are constantly interacting with others, and you are, you know, kind of making, this is also the other rule of psychology, right? That you felt unloved, and what you really wanted was love, but life is not as simple. Then, as a parent, you will again show no love. So the very thing that you hated, you end up being. Don't want to be that person.
You may feel the other way also, right?
Overlove. So that means your distortions can come in many different ways. So one
but the balance is lost.
Exactly.
This way or that way.
Exactly. One way is you yourself are not capable of loving.
Yeah.
The other one is you overlove and you become controlling. Both are distortions of the same feeling. So that means, and this is why, human beings are different, but the loads that they carry are similar. But how they behave as a result of these loads are all very different. So this is why we lose track. So this what and so what is a very big thing. It's not a small thing. Right? It is not, please don't take it as a simple thing that we are just
amazing.
Yeah.
But the way it's written is so deceptive.
Yeah.
Like, there's no way you could read this. And
I think so what is a wrong term that's being used. As in not wrong, but it's like...
It doesn't represent the point.
Yeah. It doesn't represent the point. It could have been...
Does it lead up to it later?
See, not really, but I mean the idea is this. So the thing is, like, you know, everything I have learned is from my teacher. So that means he talked about all of this, but somehow when it comes to writing, probably all this kind of got lost in some way, right? In just writing, yeah. Because you want to make it succinct, you can't write all of this, you can't give all these examples. So what happens is you just write and the whole thing is lost, right? In some ways.
And that's a two-dimension book. When you express it,
yeah,
there's a lot more dimensions.
There's a lot more.
More clarity, yeah.
So this is something which we say, that we have to learn to accept what is there and process it so that it doesn't interfere in our present perception. And as it doesn't interfere in your present perception, you can live life fully. Otherwise it will keep interfering and it will keep being impediment to your living fully. Okay? So, let's finish this. It's 10. Oh, it's 10:30. Okay, we'll stop. Yeah, this is a big thing. Let's stop. So I'll just.